creating a separate clip and go. Thank you.
That's all right. So you may or may not know, but the property tax that the county collects for county government, not for the schools and the park board and all that, but for county government, goes into what's called a corporate fund. And 72%, give or take, of that money is directly tied to paying for employees, which includes their health insurance. And the county has continued through union contracts to raise the amount of money that each employee pays for their health care, yet we're still at 72%, which, by the way, that's a huge success story. Because when Larry Walsh first became the county executive, I think we were closer to 90%. So we've definitely made improvements, but I will tell you, we know the county cannot afford health care 8 years from now. We're not going to be able to pay for it for our employees, even with all the changes and cost savings we've done. And
passing costs on to the employees.
Yes, and passing costs on and everything. So in my opinion, as a small business owner that could not offer this benefit to my employees, as a former employee of a labor union that had fabulous health insurance that I still now get to pay for and didn't have a lot of choices in, that kept me tied to a job where I might have wanted to go on and do something else. I'm totally in support of this. My question, though, is the Medicaid reimbursements.
Right.
I learned the other day from Congressman Foster that each state has a different deal.
Right.
And you always hear about Illinois being a payer state. Well, guess what? We get screwed on Medicaid, Medicare reimbursement as well. We only get 50% back of the cost. So that's why Illinois takes 25% of the money that comes in to pay for Medicare, our share of the Medicare bill. We only get 50% from federal government reimbursement rates. You go to a red state, they get 80%.
Medicaid.
So if you go to a red state, they get an 80% reimbursement rate on Medicaid, whereas here we only get 50%. So I'm just wondering if any of that would change under one of these
Medicaid bills.
Well, one of the things that has to be determined is, and this is something that's not settled yet, is what's called maintenance of effort by the states. Because the states do put different amounts of funding into health care through Medicaid. So one of the things that comes into question with funding a plan like this is, would the state still be required to pay into it, or how would that work? And it's called maintenance of effort. And that's something that really hasn't been dealt with yet, you know, because the states do put a lot of money, some do, into Medicaid, some don't. Some find barriers to get people on Medicaid, like the work requirements and things of that nature. But that's still something that would have to be figured out.
Okay. Yeah. And then what do you do about an employee who gets cash? I go clean houses, or I drive people around, or I dog sit, and I don't get, you know, a W-2. I don't pay
as
Social Security.
As
that's tax evasion.
How would you pay?
But you're still a 1099, and that's still recorded.
That's tax evasion then.
My cleaning business was a person who would do the job for cash without ever reporting that income to the federal government, without their employer, the person that hired them, ever accounting for the money. Yeah.
That's a huge amount of money,
it's
though.
It's huge.
Well, excuse me, I had my own business. It was a cash business, and I paid my taxes.
I'm talking about people cash under the table.
I know that, but the question would be, if I paid 1099 people and I had a cash business, how would I get insurance under that business?
That's a good question too.
Well, basically the Medicare for All, your insurance is not tied to your business at all.
Right.
Right. I mean, it's totally independent.
But you pay a premium somehow.
Well, you may. I mean, you know, Bernie's last bill, and again, the funding, neither of these bills has a specific funding proposal. Bernie did come up with a funding mechanism that he suggested. And what he did is he exempted small businesses from paying a payroll tax. Larger businesses, what they did is they had a graduated payroll tax, and the rates went from 5 to 8%. So say if you were paying that 8% payroll tax for an employee making $100,000, which is more than what most people make, so that's $8,000 of your payroll tax, but it costs you $18,000 to pay for that person's health insurance the way things are now. So even with the payroll tax, you're still going to come out ahead most of the time.
Would that be
so
eight,
you're saying
eight for the
you
employer?
Get to go to the doctor, you don't even necessarily have to pay any premium?
No. It's, and the thing with it.
I didn't understand that.
No, and the thing with a public option though, is that for a lot of those, you do have to buy in, you do have to pay a premium for, and it varies with the plans, because there's a lot of. But no, this, if you're not, say if you're not enrolled, you would be enrolled coming to the doctor, things like that, so everyone would get enrolled at some point, either they do it ahead of time or when they come in for a service. That's the idea of how it would work, and again, you know, specific logistics have to be worked out with that, so.
She made a good point.
What was that?
If you're being paid, you know, right now, if you're an employee, okay, you pay for half of your Medicare.
Your FICA.
Yeah, your FICA, okay?
I paid it all.
Now, what?
I paid it all.
Yeah, but if you're paying someone with a 1099, okay, they're paying everything.
Right.
Okay, so are you saying that someone who is getting paid as, you know, as a self-employed, you know, contract worker is going to be paying more than someone who is on a payroll?
I can't answer that because the specific funding is not there.
So that's all tied to funding.
Same as current Social Security.
Right, it's, yeah, Social Security, I mean, it would be the same idea, but again, the specifics in terms of rates and how that would work, you know, and taxes, because, you know, there would, right now, the government finances about 2/3 of healthcare, you know, so you still have, you have a lot of money coming in already. Now, part of that is the state money going to Medicaid, and again, that would have to be determined where that would come from. But you still have revenues that may or may not have to make up, depending on what you think about deficit spending and things of that nature. But there are ways to do it, you know, where you do, there are a variety of taxes you can do on higher income earners, on stock transactions, capital gains taxes. There have been a number of different things proposed, so it's a real, there's a lot of different ways that it could be done. Now, as a, say if you're making, if you're working for cash, like a lower income person, is that what you're asking me?
No, I'm talking about 1099.
Right.
So you're an independent contractor.
Okay.
Okay, so when you do your taxes, you not only have to pay your share of the FICA taxes, but you have to pay the employer's share of the FICA taxes.
So the rates with that, again, they could change.
That's like 16.2%, whereas otherwise you'd only pay 8.1 as employee.
Yeah, and I wish I could give you specific answers.
Yeah, there's just no funding. Yeah, that makes sense. Question. Jenny?
So I have a question. We're using the term Medicare for all. I've just recently gone on Medicare, and there's a significant cost to it. I have to buy, pay for my Part B, pay for prescriptions, pay for myself. Is that what we're talking about?
No, we're talking about that being just, it's eliminating cost. You do not, basically, it will be a tax-funded system, but as far as you having to pay for Part B, Part D, that goes away. That goes away.
Okay.
She likes that.
Well, yeah.
No, you do not have
copay. I've been confused about that because I always thought,
The thing is, if you're going to fund health care, you want to do it as a tax or as a premium. Because if it's a premium, it's going to be much more regressive. If you've got a, you know, say a just hypothetical $1,000 premium to pay, but you're making 40 versus $180,000, that's a much more aggressive way. Whereas if you do it as a tax, you know, you can make it a more progressive way where people on higher income levels will pay a bigger share. But again, it depends on how it be structured.
With the cap.
There are different proposals that are out there, but there's not one that I can tell. So I'm sorry I can't give you any more specifics.
Charla? And then Ed.
Well, no, that was my question too. I mean, we're paying for Medicare now. It's not free for those of us on Medicare.
Right, and that's what would be different.
And it would, that would change.
Yes.
Okay. Ed?
Oh, so is that why they're going to go up?
Part of it. Well, there's other reasons I can talk about.
I've heard that Medicare for All would lower auto insurance, lower homeowners insurance, lower work comp insurance, lower almost all the insurance because nobody would have to cover medical as part of those. Is that
interesting. Well, workman's comp for sure, and basically it's true. I mean, you know, the other parts of it, you don't have to cover healthcare costs. Even like, for example, for my business, malpractice insurance, because what a lot of malpractice awards go to is for future medical costs, and that we wouldn't have to pay for. I mean, it's it's a similar idea. So yes.
So there's a huge that savings isn't even included in this.
No, it's not.
So it's,
yeah, that's a good point.
It's a lot more.
Right.
We could afford Yang's plan to give everybody $1,000 a month.
I'll figure it out.
Well, we could, yeah.
Freedom dividend. Yeah. Did someone else have a question?
Do you anticipate, I mean, obviously the paying source is not there, but that it's going to be people paying income taxes, or is it going to be a combination probably of businesses?
I would say probably a combination. You know, there were probably, I mean, again, there have been a lot of different things proposed in terms of how to finance it. Like, say, for example, a tax on stock transactions. Mm-hmm. You know, that would be one mechanism. Another thing, you know, with higher capital gains rates. Maybe a wealth tax, although, again, how workable that is, it's a little hard to say. You know, so there's a lot of different possibilities that could be there. But the thing is, we have so much money sloshing around in there. It's not that we're generating new money. You know, it's not that we're having to come up with new money. It's what the money that we already put into health care is just allocated differently. That's exactly right. So the money's there. I mean, I heard this argument from an economist talk about this in the 70s, you know, when he was talking about Edward Kennedy's bill. He said, the money's there. We're not coming up with new money for a new service. We have it there. We're just allocating it differently, spending it more efficiently. So we spend way more than everyone else. The money's there. It's just where it's going.
And the people who have it don't want to share it.
Right.
I didn't catch your name, young lady.
Which one?
My name is Mehdi.
Mehdi, did you have a question? You had raised your hand.
I was going to ask if they will ever stop that Medicare coming out of your Social Security.
No, I don't know what you mean as far as like having to pay FICA taxes.
Yeah, I pay $134.
No, she's talking about
her
Medicare.
Premium.
She's
oh,
talking
premium.
About comes out of her Social
Security. Oh, the premium, that I don't know.
The Part B?
Yeah. I mean, it's probably, well, the Part B, I take that back. I mean, the idea there would be a premium paid that should be, you know, basically everyone wants to get rid of that. But again, I haven't seen the specific financing
plan.
You know, it's just not there yet. So I would hope so, and especially based on an income level, you know. But were you asking about who was trying to stop this? Could you ask that question?
Yeah.
Everybody.
Basically everyone. You know, there's a group that's called the Partnership for America's Healthcare Future that you need to be aware of. And this was a group, I mean, it sounds nice, but it's a group of hospital, pharma, and insurance lobbyists that formed this. And they're hiring former Democratic politicians to come speak to say why Medicare for All is bad.
Oh, the creepy ones.
Is one of them wrong?
You see a TV ad.
Yeah, really.
Or you see a speaker sponsored by this group, understand
Harold
who's
Ford.
The bill. Because, you know, pharma insurers, I mean, their profits typically are $30 to $60 billion a year. The profits. You know, you have executives making, you know, $8 to $10 million. Some of the pharma executives have, when they've had big years, have made just crazy amounts of money, even more crazy than $10 million a year. I mean, it's just where the money goes is just ridiculous. People profit off of illness.
Yeah.
And profit off of
where are those fools going to go?
It's hard, as he mentioned earlier, the doctor mentioned, for somebody to start a small business.
Yeah.
Really? Our first year in business with our cleaning business, we almost went broke. I actually had to borrow $5,000 from my daughter to make our workers' comp premium.
Right.
And at the end, we were paying over $100,000 a year for workers' comp insurance to insure 30 employees. I mean, and it's all based on payroll. So every time we gave an employee a raise, our premium went up.
Yeah.
It's really not a tenable situation.
What was the name of those bad people?
Of what?
The bad people.
Oh, Partnership for America's Healthcare Future.
Partnership for America's Healthcare Future, right?
Take note, Charlotte. Tom, did you have a question?
Yeah, based on the numbers and what we're looking at, what's a reasonable amount of time to do a transition, assuming there's a political will to make this happen?
Well, the two bills, they have two different plans. Bernie, the House bill, envisions 2 years, which I think would be very hard to do.
It's optimistic.
Yeah. And what they would do the first year is everyone 55 and up and 18 and over gets in.
Yeah.
And then you could also buy in as an option for that year. Then the second year, everyone's in.
Right.
Bernie's bill, it's over 4 years. It goes to 55, 45, 35, and then everyone's in. So there's a lot of, I mean, it builds on Medicare's infrastructure, so you're not really starting from scratch. But there are a lot of things that would have to be organized. I mean, one other thing that the House bill includes is global budgeting for hospitals. So what that means is that instead of a hospital having to bill for every service, a bandage, and aspirin they provide, is that a budget is determined between the government and that facility, and they get paid a lump sum of money every month for their operating expenses.
Nice.
So that saves, that is estimated to save by itself $150 billion a year, because hospitals usually have incredibly huge billing departments. So Duke University, their medical center, they've got a billing person for every hospital bed.
Wow.
And they're not really an exception, you know. I mean, so it's just stuff like that that's also in the bill that we didn't get a chance to talk about.
What are they
going to
do with all
the big cost savers?
One last question.
Yeah.
Jim.
The majority of America is all for health, Medicare for all.
Right.
big money embedded with politicians, mm-hmm. will never happen.
Well, that's certainly possible.
Could it be turned into a referendum? Could something like that be turned into a referendum where people have to actually vote on it? Because this way you take money out of it.
Starts with us. If we wanted, we could have put on the ballot, actually at the township annual meeting, we can storm the meeting, and we can ask that an advisory referendum be put on the ballot for the election, the next general election, asking or showing support for Medicare for All. And you could actually run a campaign right here in DuPage Township, and we can do that. And when all of America gets up off their...
Dead-ass.
You know what? And stop watching the video games and the realist
reality
TV reality shows and realizes their own, this is their life and they can take charge, then things will change.
Because there's so much money.
Because if we sit around and wait for the politicians,
well,
you see it happen with the gun control.
Well,
nothing's happening.
Your own, all of you are represented by Bill Foster?
Yes.
Is that right?
Yep.
Okay. So Foster is not a co-sponsor of this bill.
Nope.
He is not.
It is why he has an opponent.
Right.
This,
yeah, that's why he's
a
big primary.
Primary.
So it's, and I'm not telling you who to vote for, but I mean, if this is an important thing for you, this is what, an issue you have to think about. Because Bill Foster does not support this, of course. Neither does Lauren Underwood, Sean Kasten, Brad Schneider, up in the northern suburbs. You know, it's just, they, well, part of it is where they get money from, but part of it may be philosophical, or maybe it's a district where they're worried they would lose if they voted for it. That may be part of it, too.
I think,
you know,
that's part of Bill's thinking,
right.
And the other part is that he has other ideas about how to handle health care.
Mm-hmm.
He has said that he's fond of the system they use in Israel.
What?
What that is, I don't know.
Yeah, the Israeli system I'm not familiar with. Kasten likes Switzerland's.
They
but
have.
Switzerland's wouldn't work here. I mean,
who cares?
Just, yeah.
We need a system.
We're here.
But they have
we're
universal
here.
Insurance.
Right.
I think they have a single payer system.
Yeah.
India or China, of course, is not mentioned. So, and also Russia.
Google.
Russia has everybody gets health care. I was just there.
Hey, look at that. Oreskes know how to
yes.
do it.
Wow. And in Moscow, if you have the health care, you have the best care. When you filter out to the little cities and stuff around, that's when it starts losing.
And as far as China, their actually their system, which
they have
if I remember it, and I may be wrong about this, but their performance is certainly not worse than others. India, that I don't know. I haven't seen numbers on India, but most, I mean, you look at wealthy countries, now they all guarantee health care in some way. Now, not all of them use a single-payer system. Like the Swiss, the Germans, they still use insurance companies, but their insurance companies have to be non-profit companies, the ones that guarantee, that provide the guaranteed benefits. And they are, the level of regulation is very intense. And it's got to be nimble because companies are always going to try and find some way around things, you know. So it's just the, also their poverty level, especially like in Switzerland, is much lower, you know. So they can afford out-of-pocket expenses more than a lot of our people can. You know?
Okay.
So, anyways.
So I want to thank Dr. Perryman for coming here.
Oh, thank you. Lots of business cards. If you want to get in touch with me, if you have other groups who may want to hear about them, please reach out to me. I'm happy to do it. So.
And the reason
PNHP.
I have his card.
Yeah,
have
the cards are up there. Right.
The reason I know about them and am involved in this is I was one of the people that went to a meeting some years ago, the Illinois Single Payer Coalition. I actually made a donation and got my union to donate a little bit of money, and the group has just been building and building, and I think I've been a part of it for maybe about 8 years now.
Yeah, and PNHP is primarily a doctor's group. It has about 23,000 members nationally. So this is what we do. You know, as we go and talk and work with groups like Single Payer Coalition, to do this. And we've been around since the late 80s. You know, we started by two doctors back then, and now we're at about 23,000.
My canary in the coal mine, right. Gary, did you change your mind at all?
No.
No? Okay.
They also come and do worship services at church.
I have an idea for, I'm more inclined to Medicare for More.
Uh-huh.
Okay.
Yeah.
I mean, she brought them.
Yeah, but the thing is you look at what we spend, Medicare for More is not going to address the cost that we have, and our costs are not. So we're going to be at 20% of GDP by the mid-2020s.
Yeah, but I'm
this is
I'm
what
political.
We're worried about at the county level.
I'm more political. I'm looking at something that can pass.
Can pass, right.
Okay?
Yeah.
And Medicare for All is going to be, like, one of the big things that they have been pushing towards seniors is accessibility. Okay, they keep talking to the seniors who are on Medicare and that, and saying, well, you know what's going to happen if it's Medicare for all? You won't be able to see the doctor.
You know, we heard that argument before?
What?
When Medicare was implemented.
I know.
Yeah,
but
and when Obamacare was implemented. But this is the kind of stuff you have. There's a great
lies.
Book by a guy named Wendell Potter who used to work for the health insurance company. It's called Deadly Spit. Well worth your reading. He used to argue against this all the time, making arguments like that, you know, where you put out the idea that, you know, the system's going to be inundated or overrun, or you know, you can't afford it, you know, you're going
well,
to...
Well, the Republicans came out with that when Medicare came in, and it was going to bankrupt the country,
right.
Okay?
Yeah.
And now they're, you know, you talk to a Republican, they started Medicare, you know?
Yeah,
but you almost had Paul Ryan destroy it.
But they run.
But you know, the thing about it is what you know, what can we call?
Yeah.
And I think part of that depends on who we elect, you know, and who we get in office. But the problem is the money.
Well, and you know, we've all heard the stories about climate change, and you've got all these climate change deniers out there. And we've got people that are educated and intelligent and that they've looked at the science and they said, yeah, it's really happening. And you're going to have a group of people that are going to deny it. You've got you follow the money.
Yeah.
So we've got a group of people that have done the studies. You've got all these other countries that have health care, basic level of health care. Doesn't mean that if you're rich, you can't go out and buy something fancier or more improved or better or whatever, but a basic level of health care. And, of course, the other side is saying, oh, you're going to bankrupt the country. Well, I'm going to tell you right now, Bolingbrook's going to be bankrupt, and the county is going to be bankrupt, just under the cost of health care. I mean, you're hearing about the pension problem right now, statewide.
Excellent points.
But they're not even talking about the health care problem.
They just get the same thing, I'm sure.
So we've got more troubles ahead if we, as the people, don't step up and do things. Yeah, go
I just
ahead.
Have one more question. I'm a nurse.
Oh,
just have four.
So, in thinking about the issue in these other countries, I work with a lot of my Canadian friends when I work in Seattle.
Yeah.
Their issue is they can't get care when they need it.
Mm-hmm. See that?
And so, the problem would be the hospitals if they're going to be getting now $800 instead of their magical $36,000 for their test or whatever. People are going to be losing their jobs because they're not going to be able to do that. Is quality care going to go down because now you have that issue?
Right. Well, let me address that part first.
I don't know.
The quality care part, it'd be hard to do worse than what we have.
Right.
You know, I mean, so there's that part, the accessibility part. The issue with the shortages in services has to do with the number of providers you have. And what happened in the United States, we are much better staffed in terms of specialists, where the Canadians, you hear a lot of this stuff, especially for elective orthopedic procedures, things like that, they have to wait a long time. We will not have that issue because we have so many orthopedic surgeons in this country. Now, the problem we have is primary care.
Right.
We have a shortage of primary care docs, and part of the reason for that is because when you come out of med school, you usually owe a mortgage, essentially, about $200,000. So many students are drawn to better paying practices, which are usually specialty practices compared to primary care. But one thing you have in place with a government thing is you can actually change reimbursements to encourage people to go into more things. There will be an office of primary care that's included in the bill that will help to kind of foster that. You know, looking at alternative providers, you know, nurse practitioners, PAs, things of that nature, which I think are really going to be huge, you know, in terms of helping with that. So I don't know if that answered the question, but
I mean, you don't think more specialists and doctors, I mean, I imagine they would limit how much you would be reimbursed as well.
Well, Canadian doctors do better than a lot of us, in primary care especially. Well, internal medicine docs in Canada make more than American internists do. The surgical specialties is pretty close. I mean, they might make a little bit less. I mean, there will be doctors who would lose income with this, but it depends on your practice, because if you serve mostly poor patients with Medicaid, you're going to do better.
Right.
If you have all Blue Cross patients, you're probably going to lose some. If you are a dermatologist charging $300 for every wart you freeze, you're going to probably lose. You know, that's probably going to happen. You know, and that probably should happen.
That's
you know,
okay.
So it's, you know, so there's going to be a mix of
put
things.
A wart on
but,
his butt.
You know, but physician support's
that's
around
right,
40 to 50%, depending on the polls you look at for something like this.
How does it compensate, though? You know, you were showing, like, in California, the different rates for the MRI.
Yeah.
Now, if you're a hospital in the center, a San Francisco, or if you're 300 miles away from someplace,
right.
I said your costs are going to be hugely different.
Right. Yeah, and that's one thing where, with the payment for different facilities, you know, when that, you know, I was talking about the global budgets,
mm-hmm.
you know, when that's negotiated, that's an issue that would come up in that negotiation in terms of what are your operating costs?
Yeah.
What are your expected costs going to be?
Because cost of living is different in
multiplier
different
basis.
So that would be something to be factored into that.
You do that with federal wages.
Yeah.
They're different in different
yeah.
parts of the
there
country.
Fire departments, you know, things like that.
Yeah. No, Adam, thank you so much.
Well, thank
and,
you, everybody. I appreciate it.
I'd like to volunteer.
Great. I have a clipboard. I'll
sign me up. I want to help you do some presentations in Will County.
That's outstanding. Thank you. I'm going to turn this off and
All right. Thank you very much.